Thank you.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, with so gallantly streaming in the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free, in the home of the brave. This hygienic Asat Ankoch for a Schumen Asat Ankoch Hayastan Yurmurtika Artkan Schumen Asat Ankoch Hayastan Ahayech Paish Kis Midrash Neron jede kuinov norina kan mit nashan toch noch noi tschna budem toch mich panza ajastan toch noch noi tschna budem Toch mischt Panzer Hayastan.
Honored survivors, families of survivors and families of those who perished, Reverend clergy, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon and welcome to the State House. I just have to say that looking out at all of you and at this sea of Armenian and American flags, this is a truly special, special moment. Thank you all so much for being here. My name is Jonathan Hecht, State Representative for Watertown and Cambridge, and I will be Master of Ceremonies for the State House commemoration of the 100th anniversary of the Armenian Genocide. To begin with, I just want to offer our thanks to Nune Karapetian, who just gave us that beautiful rendition of the national anthems of the United States and the Republic of Armenia. Thank you, Nune. For the last 7 years, it has been my great honor to help organize and lead the annual State House commemoration of the Armenian Genocide. I want to acknowledge the other current members of the legislature who have also been part of that effort, and to thank them for their dedication to ensuring that the Armenian Genocide is recognized and remembered. Senator Will Brownsberger of Belmont. Representative John Lawn of Watertown. Representative James Maselli of Wilmington. Representative David Moradian of Grafton. And Representative David Rogers of Cambridge. As many of you know, the annual State House commemoration is a tradition that goes back 30 years to Speaker George Kavarian. Normally, we hold the commemoration inside in the House chamber. It is a deeply moving event filled with prayer, music, an eloquent remembrance of the genocide committed against the Armenians in Turkey early in the last century. This year, as part of the statewide commemoration, we are here in the open air, before the world, to send a strong message. 100 years is far, far too long. It is long past time for the entire international community, including our own government in Washington, and especially the Turkish government in Ankara, to acknowledge the historical truth of the Armenian Genocide. Genocide is a crime against all humanity. It is the cause of all humanity to ensure that no genocide is ever denied or forgotten. We in Massachusetts are committed to this cause, to honoring and comforting the victims, survivors, and descendants of the Armenian Genocide, to upholding justice and the truth of those tragic events, and to preventing the recurrence of genocide anywhere in the world. I am proud to say that we have with us today the highest leaders of the Commonwealth to affirm this commitment. Our first speaker is Senator Harriet Chandler of Worcester. As Majority Leader of the Senate, Senator Chandler is the second highest ranking member of that body. Among her many accomplishments in the legislature, she has been a champion for social justice and for promoting the health of all our residents, especially children. I know she takes particular pride in representing the large, vibrant Armenian community in the Worcester region. Please join me in welcoming Senate Majority Leader Harriet Chandler.
Thank you, Representative Hecht, honored guests, members of the Armenian community, and dear friends. Today, we remember the lives that were lost beginning 100 years ago today, April 24th, 1915. The anniversary of the Armenian Genocide is a day that marks a century of grief and longing for acknowledgement. However, it is a day that also brings renewed hope for resolution. Over the decades, the Armenian community has exemplified great resiliency and commitment to accountability for all that was lost 100 years ago. Looking around, we see how the Armenian community has truly flourished and prospered in Massachusetts. Massachusetts hosts the second largest Armenian community in the United States, after California. I would also...
Thank you.
I would also like to note that the first Armenian church in the nation was established in Worcester, which I represent. I say it is time for the Turkish government to acknowledge that indeed it was a genocide. The government of 25 countries and 43 states in the United States recognize the events as a genocide. This week, the European Parliament and the Pope acknowledge the events as a genocide. Until it is recognized, the Armenian people, wherever they are in the world, will lack closure to the tragedy that happened 100 years ago. But for today, we celebrate the Armenian community and their enriching presence in the United States. Through this commemoration ceremony at the State House, we seek to honor those who have lost their lives and have been given sainthood, and also those who have found refuge here. We hope that this centennial marks a new beginning for the greater Armenian community across the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Chandler. Our next speaker is the speaker, the leader of the House of Representatives, Robert DeLeo. Speaker DeLeo has been a member of the legislature since 1991 and was first elected speaker in 2009. His many outstanding achievements as a member and speaker of the House include landmark legislation on economic development, public safety, and expanding opportunity for persons with disabilities. Every year since he became speaker, Speaker DeLeo has personally attended and addressed the State House Genocide Commemoration. No speaker since George Kavarian has been more supportive of this event and the cause of the Armenian people than Speaker DeLeo. Please join me in welcoming the Speaker of the House, Robert A. DeLeo.
Thank you very much, Representative Hecht, for that very kind introduction. I'd also like to say, for those of you who during the national anthems of the United States and Armenia were saying how short that Speaker DeLeo is, I want to remind you I was standing between Baker and Katusian. So I thank you for that placement. Good afternoon to all of you, and thank you so much for joining us here today. Over the past few years, I've had the distinct honor to host this commemoration in the House chamber. As we mark the 100th anniversary of the Armenian Genocide, I am heartened that because of the large turnout, we're gathering today in Ashburton Park. Look around you. Our State House has a storied history that I feel exemplifies democracy. Its legacy is particularly resonant today, when as we mark this solemn occasion, We also celebrate the Armenian community and the contributions that immigrants and their descendants have made to public life in our great state. I came to this issue through the traditions of the House of Representatives. As was just mentioned, one of my great predecessors, Speaker Kavarian, began this commemoration years ago. He had the courage to speak up at a time when many Americans did not know about the genocide. And by the way, I'd like to mention his grandniece is with us here today. Through leaders like Speaker Kavarian, I have learned more about the Armenian heritage and the Armenian genocide. It's interesting to note that before my first year as Speaker, as we went to the commemoration, I did a couple of things. First of all, I tried to speak to Peter Katusian to help me with the Armenian language. That did not work out very well. But secondly, I have a book, which I think the governor now has one, that someone had given me. It was a book by the Armenian author Peter Balakian. It's called The Burning Tigris, which I'm sure many of you know about. And I still keep that book in my office. In that, through that book, I learned that there was a group of vocal Americans committed to raising awareness of the genocide, even as it was happening during World War I. That is our past. And as we look towards the future, I hope that events like this will encourage people all across this nation and world to fully and completely recognize these atrocities for what they were, a genocide. I believe that with this acknowledgement, our communities can begin a new phase of healing and reaffirm in ourselves the shared values that lift us up. While we remember those who perished, we must vow to carry on their legacy to ensure that the world never forgets. Following the event here today, there will be a procession to the Armenian Heritage Park on the Greenway. As we reflect today, I urge each of you to consider that symbolism of the Heritage Park and the gratitude we owe to the Armenian community, which is an exemplary pillar of American values. As humans, as Americans, we must ensure that human spirit outshines in humanity. Today's commemoration will help us renew that commitment. Thank you so much for having me here today.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Our next speaker is His Excellency, Governor of the Commonwealth, Charlie Baker. Governor Baker has had a distinguished career in both the private and public sectors, with a focus on health care and human services. In his first 100 days in office, he has shown an admirable spirit of collaboration and willingness to tackle tough problems with fresh ideas and energy. Governor, we were touched by your remarks at last night's memorial service at Trinity Church. And we are deeply grateful for your presence here today. It means so much to all of us who care about the Armenian genocide to know that our governor stands with us. Ladies and gentlemen, Governor Baker.
Thank you very much, Representative, and thank you all for being here today. And Mr. Speaker, let me just tell you that my good friend Bob Avakian, also thought it would be helpful if I said a few things in Armenian until he heard me try. And then he said, Governor, just stick to what you're good at. Where's Bob? He's around here somewhere. There he is. Thank you, Bob. Big help. Honored guests, friends, and I just want to add, Attorney General, the Attorney General, Maura Healey, the Auditor, Suzanne Bump, the Treasurer, Deborah Goldberg, thank you so much for being here as well. And the Governor's Counselor from Watertown, Marilyn Devaney. I thank you for inviting me here today to join you as we observe the centennial commemoration of the Armenian Genocide here at the State House. I want you to know, as your governor, I stand proudly with the Armenian American community on this issue. The Armenian American community is a wonderful force for good in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. As Senator Chandler pointed out, this state is home to the oldest Armenian church in America, and outside of California, which is a little bigger than we are, we have the second largest Armenian community in the nation. And we will never forget, ever, that 100 years ago, over 1 million Armenians were killed by the Ottoman Empire. We will never forget. First, it was the intellectuals, the writers, doctors, lawyers, educators, then the rest, including women and children. Our nation's efforts were noble and notable to help save those who survived the genocide at that time. But as I stand here and look out at some of the pictures around me, we should never forget those who were lost. It was mentioned that the Pope spoke to this earlier this week, in which he said, unless we stop the bleeding and bound the wound, it will continue to bleed. Pope Francis further called on world leaders to stand up against the denial of the Armenian Genocide. And as I rode home last night, I noticed that the Chancellor of Germany stood up and did just that yesterday. Well, good for him. Her. Thanks, Dave. And today we have a chance to reaffirm our record on the Armenian Genocide, as Massachusetts and 42 other states have already done. I'm proud that our state continues to stand firm on this issue and educates our students about the history of the Armenian Genocide in public schools through the Facing History curriculum. And we are hopeful that through this learning and through educating future generations about these tragic events, we can do our part to ensure that they never happen again. Now, Bob, this is for you. God bless your Armenian saints. May we always remember them and stand by them for as long as it takes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Governor. Didn't she give a wonderful speech? I also want to add my thanks to the other constitutional officers who are here with us today, We really appreciate your presence. It means, again, so much to know that so many of our leading government officials in this state stand with all of us and with the Armenian community on this cause. Thank you. Several times we've heard mention today of George Kaverian, who was a great Armenian American and a great speaker of the Massachusetts House. Through the years, the Massachusetts legislature has been enriched by other noted Armenian Americans, including my predecessor, Rachel Kaprielian, Sheriff Peter Katujan, and current State Representative James Maselli, whose grandmother was an Armenian genocide survivor. This last January, we welcomed another outstanding Armenian American to our ranks. Representative David Meradian of Grafton has quickly made his mark as a skilled and collegial legislator. And he has become a key member of our team of Armenians by birth and Armenians by choice, who have the privilege to organize this annual commemoration. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Representative David Meradian.
Parev, my friends. Thank you for taking part in the State House commemoration. As my good friend and colleague said, my name is David Meradian, and I have the privilege of being the state representative of the towns of Grafton, Northbridge, and Upton, which has many Armenians, in like myself and like most of you, in our communities. I do want to thank all the elected officials, the governor, speaker, Senate Majority Leader, and the many distinguished guests who are here today standing strong to commemorate the 100th anniversary of the Armenian Genocide. As the governor said 100 years ago in 1915, most Armenian doctors, educators, writers, intellectuals, lawyers, and community leaders were rounded up and viciously killed or forced into death marches leading into the Syrian desert. This massacre left 1.5 million Armenians dead. Genocide across the world has had a profound effect, and that rings true right here in the Massachusetts legislature. We have had our share of Armenian members, as we had just referenced the late speaker George Kaverian, the registrar, and the high sheriff, who will, I believe, be speaking next. In fact, in just this past election cycle, my friend and colleague, Ratty Mom, who himself has survived the Cambodian genocide, was elected, making him the first Cambodian representative elected in the House of Representatives. As my friend the governor pointed out, in the United States, the first Cambodian. We come here today to honor the martyrs who went before us and who had their lives taken from them. There is no doubt that this was a horrific incident encased in a horrid part of history. Throughout my schooling, when I was younger, I would insist on covering the Armenian Genocide for any projects or presentations. I grew up on stories of the old country from my great uncle Nick, who unfortunately is no longer with us, but it's because of him that I have taken such a great pride in my heritage. My uncle Nick was a survivor of the genocide and left a lasting impression on me through one specific story. During the genocide, he watched Ottoman government members kill his father in front of him for the slippers on his feet. I sit here to this day and am astonished that any individual can say that this was not a systematic attempt to destroy our people. However, I am proud to say that Massachusetts recognizes the commencement of this genocide every year, and none more fitting than this, the 100th anniversary. We have even seen Pope Francis come out and call on world leaders to stand up against the denial of the Armenian Genocide. Even some of our own United States presidents, past and present, come short in using the word genocide. It's an absolute disgrace that maintaining relations is more important than honoring our history. Mr. President, I implore you, end the denial and officially declare a genocide once and for all. This is not a partisan issue. I stand here with an R next to my name and some of my best friends with a D next to theirs. But we should all stand united in having an A for Armenian next to all of our names. We must recognize the happenings of 100 years ago. Our wounds have started to heal, but we all have scars that remain. The healing process truly begins when all involved take responsibility for their role. We will never be able to change what happened, but we can all help with continuing to educate so that this history never repeats itself. I must tell you why my great uncle Nick's father refused to give up his slippers. And it was from all of his hard work that allowed him to buy them. It was because he was too proud to give them up. And that's what we are. We are too proud to let the atrocity that happened 100 years ago define us. We'll continue to teach individuals of our history and show our pride in our heritage. We must take time to reflect and remember all of our family and friends whose lives were taken away from them. But we also must take time and appreciate how just 100 years ago, our heritage was almost wiped out, yet we are here today, and we have proudly become those doctors, those educators, those writers, those intellectuals, those community leaders. I am proud to be a state representative, I am proud to be an Armenian American, and I am certainly proud to walk arm in arm with each and every one of you down to our Heritage Park. Thank you and God bless. It is my distinguished honor to introduce a very good friend of mine, the High Sheriff of Middlesex County, Peter Katusian.
Parev! I am so proud to stand with my brothers and sisters and our children and our parents and our grandparents and those that we remember today. And when we walked out into this park, I have never been more moved to be at an Armenian event in my life, to see the sea of people, the sea of Armenian flags before this auspicious beginning building. This is an amazing day for our people, is it not? I just returned from Washington, D.C. just last night, where I was participated in the Congressional Armenian Commemoration, where we called all the members of Congress and the United States Senate to come down and speak about our genocide. And there were hundreds of our people there, and there were dozens of senators and congressmen that took time to be there, despite they were rushing out for flights, despite they were rushing out for other appointments, to be there to stand and speak with our community, one after the other after the other. And it made me so proud to know the clout, the power, the influence, and the belief that we have in Washington, D.C., across this nation. And when you think it can't get much better than after the Pope announces and commemorates our genocide, and finally, was that not gratifying? Did it not make you say, finally someone has spoken on our behalf, didn't it? But then we hear one other sign from just yesterday. A man who has brought us so much into this area. A man that has brought us 4 Super Bowls already, Bill Belichick. Do you all know what he did? At the White House reception for the New England Patriots, the Super Bowl champions, Bill Belichick not only wore a suit, he wore an Armenian flag pin right on his lapel, right in front of President Obama. It may not be the Pope, folks, but that's pretty darn good, isn't it? And we'll have to find out which of our friends, which one got to him, too, on that. Because this goes to show you the power that we have when we speak to our friends and build our relationships. This is an auspicious building. We are here before this auspicious big building. The oldest constitution continually in use in the entire world right now started right here in Massachusetts. A place where the legislature, these great men and women behind us and their predecessors, our predecessors, pushed for the teaching of Armenian genocide in our public curriculum in our schools, right? You remember that one? This legislature pushed for the recognition for the independence of Karabakh and the recognition of Karabakh. Remember that one? This legislature recognized the Armenian genocide many years ago. Do you remember that one? And this legislature started with our good friend, Speaker George Kaverian, Nairi's grand uncle. George Kaverian started this Armenian commemoration that started decades ago and has continued on. It has been led by Speaker Kaverian, by our Registrar of Motor Vehicles, now working for the federal government, Rachel Kaprolian, by myself. But we always have to remember our non-Armenian friends, the Tolman brothers that led this for many years. Remember that? By the way, I sort of do miss doing that in the morning where Stephen Tolman would always come up and say, Pari Louise. So, Mr. Speaker, trust me, it's better you don't try that stuff. It was kind of painful, but it was always really fun, and we always loved Stephen Tolman and his brother Warren for leading us. And our great friend John Hecht, who has also led this for so many years. On another hand for John Hecht, that has been a great leader. Speaking of other great Senate leaders, we've got a couple that have joined us here. Senator Lewis from Winchester. Senator Jason Lewis is right here. Thank you for being here with us. Senator Michael Barrett also is here. So thank you, Senator Michael Barrett, many of our constituents. And we've now moved on. Representative McGonigal from Everett is here, I understand, too. There you go, Joe. Great to see you, sir. Former hometown of George Kaverian. Thank you, Joe, for being here. And of course, now we've got a great friend. We now have an Armenian, an IAN, that's going to be back in the back of that rostrum, David Maradian. So we're so proud to have David there as well. Just a couple of notes about our governor. Thank you so much for being here, Governor. Thank you for speaking so informedly, so plainly, so openly. And people here should understand that it never was a hesitation for a moment for the governor to join us in our message. He knew it before he became governor. He never had to be convinced. This was an easy choice for him, and thank you very much, Governor Baker, for your leadership. Never a hesitation on this. And of course, our great speaker, Dalia, who has been here every single year and prepares something meaningful and different each year. Thank you so much. And we've got almost every constitutional officer here, along with other leaders, Treasurer Goldberg, Auditor Bump, Attorney General Healy, all here along with our governor and our Speaker of the House. This is a great day. Let's think about why we're here, though. April 24th, 100 years ago, after decades of slaughters, when many of our people came to this great country to flee the slaughters before the genocide, when we suddenly thought we had hope because the Young Turks came to us and said, we would like to have you join us in government. We will create a constitution. We will give you constitutional rights. And then we were betrayed. On April 24th, hundreds of our leaders were slaughtered. Our political leaders, our educators, our intellectual leaders were taken and summarily slaughtered.
From that point, they took our able-bodied men, most of them in their military, and took them down. And then thousands upon thousands upon thousands upon hundreds of thousands of men, women, and children were led into the desert to be slaughtered summarily, to be led to their death of dehydration and starvation, sometimes making it to concentration camps in Syria, and then being led further into the desert from that point, just for the systematic purpose of destroying an entire people. By the way, we should understand that genocide cannot be committed by a group. It has to be committed by a government, doesn't it? They're the only people in charge enough to commit genocide is a government. We can tell the stories, we all have them. My grandparents, Abraham and Zarahi, who lived in Marash, that left Marash with nothing but the clothes on their backs, becoming separated on their way. Not much different from so many of the stories of your grandparents, your great-grandparents, your aunts and uncles, so many loved ones here that left Marash with nothing but the clothes on their back. And finally, I won't tell you about the journey, but it was much as yours were. They saw death and devastation on their way. They suffered greatly. They saw their neighbors and their friends and their loved ones dead on the sides of the roads. But let me tell you something. As they came to this great country, they became the greatest patriots by raising four great children, including my father, and who just passed this year, another survivor gone, by the way. Thank you so much for your prayers and thoughts for my dad, who was a great leader for our community for so many years as well. This is my first year without my dad for the genocide, and it's a difficult year for me. But they made it to this country, and they survived. Well, let me just say something here to Turkey. You failed. We survived, didn't we? And as we are about to begin our procession down to Armenian Heritage Park, this will be a solemn procession. We will be thinking about the very marches that many of our relatives went through, many of our people went through. We'll be thinking of their loss, of what they must have been thinking as they proceeded, not knowing where they were going. We know that they will think of the tunnel that was dark, but for us there is a light at the end of that tunnel, and it will be led by our honor guard. And that light at the end of the tunnel is probably our greatest civic achievement here in Greater Boston area, Armenian Heritage Park, right? And that was a project that started in the dark, and we fought for many years. It started with Rachel and I filing an amendment back in 1999 in fighting and fighting and fighting. And despite great opposition by many, so many, we all know who they were, we, through our unanimity, through 13 churches and 25 organizations, all deciding unanimously on a design and how to proceed with the leadership of the Knights of Vatan and Jim Kalusian, we made that happen. One of the best days we've had in Greater Boston was that day. So after 20 dark days, that happened. Let me just close by saying one thing. The genocide happened to us, but we are not defined by the genocide, are we? We are strong, we are survivors, we are perseverant, we have succeeded. Turkey has failed, we are here. We have defeated them. So we must understand that while we commemorate our loss, while we think of our genocide, something we must do, we must always never be victims of that genocide. We have overcome that genocide. We have succeeded in spite of their acts. And as we go on, I say, in sort of paraphrasing Ronald Reagan, Mr. President, recognize this genocide. We need to recognize this genocide, and we need to do this for the world, not just for us as diaspora Armenians. We need to do this for the world. We need to do this for Turkey, right? Because if Turkey recognizes this genocide, then we can all move on. This is a wound that is festering under a bandage, and no one wants to take that bandage off. We are all afraid to take that bandage off because of what we might find. We all pretend it's healing underneath there, and it's never going to heal until we take that bandage off. And we know that many times you just have to rip that bandage off as quickly as possible to open that up, to let it heal, to let the sun shine in, to begin that healing process and make us all better and stronger. Thank you so much for being here. God bless Armenia, God bless the United States of America. Recognize this genocide. The march will begin, I'm being told, this way. Is that correct, Commissioner?
Thank you. back then. I saw Larry Tucker. It was good.
Oh, yeah.
No, actually, he'd be some great.
Here he comes.
established to bring music to the young children, Armenian children of Greater Boston. Please join the choir under the direction of Hasmik Kanjoyan in the singing of the national anthems of the United States and the Republic of Armenia.
Ladies and gentlemen, please rise.
Survivors of the genocide. Elected officials, reverend clergy, honored guests, friends, good afternoon and welcome. My name is James Kalusian. Along with Antony Barsamyan and Arad Azaryan, I've had the privilege of serving as co-chair of the Massachusetts Committee to commemorate the 100th anniversary of the Armenian Genocide. I welcome you all, Armenians and non-Armenians alike, to today's commemoration here at an Armenian Heritage Park. This park was built and gifted to our great city and Commonwealth in 2012 by the Armenian American community of Massachusetts as a way of saying thank you for the opportunities afforded those who survived the genocide and made their way up to America to seek higher education, new opportunity for their families, and the freedom to worship in their own faith. At the center of the park where you're seated here is a granite labyrinth inlaid into the central lawn of the park. It symbolizes life's journey, and today it symbolizes the journey of the Armenian people. At the center of that labyrinth is a single jet of water which symbolizes hope and rebirth of life. At this point in the journey of the Armenian people, we are gathered as direct descendants of survivors and today as direct descendants of saints of the Armenian Church who survived the atrocities perpetrated 100 years ago against the Armenian population of Ottoman Turkey. But let the naysayers and denialists hear our voices loud and clear. This park is more than a symbol of hope, for we are not gathered here as victims of genocide. On the contrary, we are here today to demonstrate to the world that we are victors. Victors over oppression. Victors over those who would attempt to exterminate a culture, a religion, and an entire people. And victors over the revisionists who say the first-hand accounts of those survivors who created a new life here in America exaggerated the truth. That is why in last night's ecumenical prayer service and in today's program, we do not just commemorate, as we always do and always will, but we also, in a small way, celebrate a culture, a faith, an undefeatable human spirit that was not extinguished in 1915, but still thrives and flourishes today here in America and across the world. And as we begin our program, we give thanks to all of you for being with us today, especially those from the Greek community, the Jewish community, the Rwandan community, and so many other communities who share our suffering and our commitment to end the tragedy of genocide from the face of the earth. For by standing here together as one people, regardless of faith, regardless of nationality, regardless of nomination, we show the world that the genocide committed in 1915 was not just a crime committed against the Armenian people, but it was a crime committed against mankind. Our first speaker today is a longtime supporter of congressional resolutions on the Armenian genocide. I'm pleased to present our congressman from the 7th Congressional District, the Honorable Michael Capuano.
First of all, this is an amazing crowd. Thank you all for being here. There's not much I can say that's going to change anything, except to tell you that you have many, many friends in Congress. And for me, it's not about denigrating other people. It's about simply acknowledging facts. Bad things happen in the world, and when they do, we need to acknowledge them. We need to apologize if we participate in them. And we need to find ways to move forward. This, to me, is an easy issue. I don't understand the other side. I don't understand why we have this problem. Days like this keep this issue at the forefront, keep the memories of those who went before us at the forefront. And for that, I'm thankful for you to be here, and I'm particularly thankful and proud that I've been allowed to be here with you.
There is much I could say about our next speaker. We as a community and we as individuals have been through a lot together. his moral courage and actions to, as he often said, do the right thing, have earned him our eternal respect, gratitude, admiration, and love. Simply put, we would not be in Armenian Heritage Park today were it not for our good friend who has become an Armenian through choice and through action, the 71st governor of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, the Honorable Deval Patrick.
Good afternoon, brothers and sisters. Thank you so much. Thank you, Jim, for the almost always warm welcome to the elected officials, president, reverend clergy, to all my brother and sister Armenians. Thank you for including me in today's solemn occasion. It's good to be back on this hallowed ground with all of you. My hope today is that as we acknowledge the genocide of Armenians 100 years ago, we also, as Jim so beautifully put it, celebrate your and their resilience. Your grandmothers and grandfathers, your great-grandmothers and great-grandfathers, maybe even some of you suffered profoundly through a painful period of systematic violence. But today you are doctors, lawyers, teachers, scholars, business leaders, civic leaders, public and community servants, members of our community. And that example of generational resilience is a living tribute to those who were lost and an example for all of us. God bless you, and thank you for having me.
In addition to those on your program, we're very pleased to have with us many elected officials from state and local government.
We thank them for their presence. We're also very, very grateful for the attendance and support of the consul generals of over 15 nations. Thank you very much for being with us today, and thank you for your support. The Sayat Nova Dance Company is the leading Armenian dance company of North America. Founded here in Massachusetts in 1986, Sayat Nova is a not-for-profit, all-volunteer organization under the direction of Apo Ashjan. They are committed to the preservation and promotion of Armenian culture through the art of dance. The company takes its name from the famous 18th century troubadour Sayat Nova, whose works are often said to capture the essence of Armenian culture and spirit, the Sayat Nova Dance Group.
Thank you.
Tried to destroy our churches, our culture, our language. See if today we did not sing and dance once again. See if today we did not create a new Armenia. Isn't that right? It's my great pleasure to introduce a good friend of our community, Mayor Martin Walsh, who is an accomplished advocate for working people and a proud product of the city of Boston. He was sworn in as the city's 54th mayor on January 6, 2014. Martin has always had a commitment to community, equality, and opportunity for every resident and neighborhood. Mayor Walsh has the record, the skills, and passion to move Boston forward and to fill the very large and powerful shoes of Mayor Thomas Menino as well. Martin and I entered the legislature together in 1997, and together we traveled some years later to Jerusalem, at which point I was able to bring the mayor to the Armenian Quarter. And immediately upon entering the Armenian Quarter, it was a life-changing event for the mayor, because in that place, he became Thanami, he became family to us. So much so, that when it came time to build this beautiful park, along with many friends, including especially Governor Patrick, who this really wouldn't have happened without Governor Patrick, by the way, we should really make sure that people understand that. It's true. We and many other friends, and many friends from the areas that were not around here, one great friend, a state representative from Dorchester, now mayor of the great city of Boston, Martin J. Walsh.
Thank you very much, Sheriff, and we had an incredible trip going to the Armenian Quarter in Jerusalem with Peter. And, much like my heritage, Irish heritage, he immediately connected. And I will tell one story. We went there in the area of Jerusalem where the Armenian Quarter is. The doorways are about 4 feet high. So when Peter came to the door and knocked on the door, the bishop came out, and they all wanted to bring him back in because they wanted to figure out how this such tall Armenian get here. But I want to thank Peter, and he's a dear friend. James, I want to thank you and everyone at the Armenian Heritage Foundation. I want to thank you as well for this unique space in our city, the Armenian Heritage Park. It's a tangible example of how your community has turned suffering into strength and shared this strength with all of us here in the city of Boston. The presence of the leadership here today, testifies the importance of this occasion. Governor Patrick, Senators Warren and Markey, Congressman Capuano, and many other members of the legislature, as well as my former colleague in the House of Representatives, Peter's former colleague, Rachel Propelli, Regional Director of the United States Health and Human Service Office. I also want to thank many of the community organizers that make up the Armenian Genocide Centennial Committee, from religious congregations to cultural organizations, from veterans posts to professional societies. This network shows how immigrant community can strengthen and grow in over a few short years. Today, all of Boston, Massachusetts, and all of America stands with your community. We stand with you to remember the profound injustice and deep trauma, the genocide, violence waged on your parents, grandparents, cousins, and countrymen 100 years ago. We stand with you in symphony as brothers and sisters, neighbors and friends, and just as important, we accept shared obligation to remember the 1.5 million victims, to honor the survivors and their descendants, and to learn from the past so we may prevent such injustices from ever happening again. What we learned from history strengthens us as a community. What we learned to listen to the voices of the vulnerable. We learned to speak up and stand against injustice, whether at home or around the world. We learned to respect every culture while forging bonds of deep friendship, so that our one diverse society can be a community in which no one is harmed or excluded. 100 years ago, Bostonians and New Englanders forged a bond with the Armenian people. After hearing testimony from the survivors, our predecessors started America's first international human rights movement. It wasn't enough to stop the terror, but it planted a powerful seed of justice in our city and our nation's history. And from then it grew into Boston's deep relationship with the Armenian people. Armenians preserved and brought their culture and community from all over the world, and especially right here in the city of Boston and the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Greater Boston is proud to have one of the three largest Armenian communities in the United States of America. It's a community of high achievement and generous spirit. Perhaps most important, today shows us Armenians have helped Boston become a more resilient city. We are a city of people from all over the world, and we have survived every hardship, from famine to Holocaust, to racial violence and war. The survivors and their descendants have brought us deep reserves of strength to our community. It's a strength that needs in time adversity, but it's a strength that requires us to know the names of these traumas and these impacts. Today we grow stronger together by bearing witness to America's community hard struggle and continuing perseverance. So we acknowledge this history without reservation. We stand with you as the long journey of healing continues, and we give thanks for the deep channels of strength that flows from the Armenian people into our city, into our country. Thank you, and God bless you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. A special thank you to Rob Lichten of the American Jewish Committee, Georgia Murray, Chair of the Greenway, and much of her staff for their support in making our park as beautiful as it is today. As well, we thank the sponsors listed in your programs whose generosity have made this week's programs possible. Dr. Dikron Kalyan is a historian who has specialized in Armenian-Turkish relations in the last years of the Ottoman Empire. He is chairman of the Armenian National Committee of Eastern Massachusetts and a member of the steering committee of the Massachusetts Centennial Commemoration, and I can say with deep conviction after this last year's process, a good friend of mine. Please welcome Dr. Dikron Kalyan.
Thank you, Jim. As we have approached the centenary of the Armenian Genocide, a wave of pressure has been building on Turkey. But they've been preparing this for years, and their chief tactic in preparation has been to try to divide the Armenian people. The Turkish government desperately wants to divide us so they can avoid giving us justice. So they try to create false divisions between ideological Armenians and pragmatic Armenians, radical Armenians and realistic Armenians, diasporan Armenians and Armenian-born Armenians. To do this, they create phony arguments. They tell us the Armenians and Armenia don't care about the genocide issue.
They only want security and a better economy. But we know this isn't true. So we cannot fall into Turkey's trap. We cannot allow ourselves to be divided, because we know what we can do when we're united. In the 1990s, Azerbaijan's army vastly outnumbered the armies of Karabakh. Azerbaijan, with Turkey's military support, was sure they would have no problem massacring yet another group of helpless Armenians and driving them too out of their homes and out of their homeland. But we know what actually happened. The Armenians of Karabakh fought back. And with the Armenians of Armenia and the Armenians of the diaspora, they not only stopped the Azeri army, they drove it back 100 miles. Get to Aksaki Marginal. Turkey's worldwide, multi-million-dollar genocide denial campaign concerns us not just as Armenians, but as Americans. Because the main battleground for this cover-up is here in the United States. This denial has corrupted our Defense Department, because they always give in to Turkey blackmail. And they convinced President Obama and President Bush before him, oh no, you can't use that dangerous word or we'll lose our air bases. This denial has corrupted our public schools, as Turkey tries to remove the word genocide from high school textbooks. And this denial has corrupted our colleges, as Turkey is funding a denial factory at the University of Utah that is churning out denialist PhDs and is publishing and sending out free to libraries across the country a string of denial books that have been rejected by all legitimate publishers. But this wall of denial is cracking. When the Pope and the European Parliament, and Austria, and Germany, and newspapers around the world are calling on Turkey to finally come to terms with its own history, we see what the reaction is. From Turkey, we see President Erdogan stomping his feet, recalling his ambassadors, and having his Prime Minister call the Pope part of an evil front. But we also see the reaction from Turkey's defenders in this country. So, to their everlasting shame, the State Department continues to submit to Turkey's gag rule. Its friends suddenly get published this month in the national media, mislabeling our fight for justice as hatred, and claiming that the diaspora's fight for recognition hurts the security of Armenia. But we've heard this tune before from them. It used to be, don't fight for Karabakh or you'll lose Armenia, but we know it's just a smokescreen. So, we must ask our friends in Congress who are here with us today to please go to the State Department and remind them a few things. Remind them it is not Armenia that has refused to have diplomatic relations, it is Turkey. It is not Armenia that has blockaded its neighbor for 20 years, it is Azerbaijan and it is Turkey. It is not Armenia that is desperately covering up its own history, it is Turkey, and it is time for the State Department to start stopping an accomplice to this cover-up. One day soon, Turkey and its public relations agencies will craft some kind of acknowledgement. But it is not sincere if Turkey apologizes without paying the price of reparations and restitution. It is only justice if Armenia and the Armenian people receive more than just words on a piece of paper. It is only justice when Armenia receives back the lands and the properties and the farms and the businesses and the wealth that was stolen by Turkey. The world must recognize that the Republic of Turkey was built on Armenian blood and Armenian sweat and Armenian labor, and that is why reparations are an integral part of justice for the Armenian genocide. Now, we in the diaspora are often accused of being obsessed with the genocide. But our demand for justice is actually very practical. because Armenia will never be truly safe next door to an unrepentant genocide denier. Turkey is determined to keep Armenia subservient, because it knows the one thing that is hanging over its head is Armenia's demand for justice. Turkey refuses to allow Artsakh to be reunited with Armenia, because then Armenia would be able to feed itself. Turkey refuses to allow discussion of the stolen lands of Western Armenia, because with them, Armenia would have defensible borders and an outlet to sea so it could no longer be blockaded. So, on this day, when we stand here and in cities across the globe, we say this. We say that Armenia will never be truly secure and truly free until Artsakh is a part of the Republic of Armenia. Armenia will never be truly free until Jabbok is a part of the Republic of Armenia. Armenia will never have national security until Western Armenia is a part of the Republic of Armenia.
Is a highly regarded musician and student of traditional Armenian folk music and wind and percussion instruments. He has studied at the Gilmedes Conservatory in Yerevan, Armenia, as well as here at the UMass in Boston. Martin has performed extensively internationally, as well as here in the U.S., including with our own Boston Pops. Today, Martin will be performing Dali Yaman on one of the most traditional of Armenian instruments, the duduk. Rose. I would be remiss if I did not, on behalf of all of us,
some 3,000 strong, by the way, I did not offer our heartfelt thanks and appreciation to Dusty and her amazing staff at the convention. It's all the way to pull this off. Just for the record, we didn't go to Dusty. She came to us. She said, I want to help. I want my team to help. I want this to be a memorable event. And she helped us pull it off. Thank you again. We couldn't do it without you. The mission of the Yenapuri Dance Ensemble is to provide an educational environment for children where they can learn the fundamentals of the art of dance in a very structured manner. Their primary goal is to teach Armenian traditional folk dances to our children in order to keep our traditions and cultural heritage alive in the hearts of our younger generations. The Yenapuri Dance Ensemble. Thank you.
many of you are well aware, all of the bishops and primates of the Armenian Apostolic Church are in Armenia for the services that took place yesterday to sanctify the victims of the Armenian Genocide who died for their faith. But we are very fortunate to have with us today Reverend Father Daniel Findikian, the former dean of the St. Nessus Seminary in New Rochelle, New York, and currently the director of the Zoram Information Center at the Eastern Diocese of the Armenian Church, who will lead us in prayer. Father Daniel.
May I ask you all to stand as we pray together to our new holy martyrs of the genocide of 1915, that God will hear their prayer and ours and grant us the peace and the justice and the truth that we all so desperately crave. Hanunhor, Yevort Vo, Yevort Queen Serpo, Amen. Surperu Busagich of Christos, Vorhu Busagis Surperet, Yevgir Gadaris Ganke, Kesme Yevgubat Nerun. Եվ սիրով ու քաղցրության գնայիս քու արարած ներում, լսեմ ես, երնային սրբութեն է, պարեխոսության բսուրբ ասվածածնի, և աղաչանքովը քու փոլոր սուրբերուտ, և մանավանդ այն սուրբ նահատակներում, որոնք մարդիրոսացան հայոց ցեղասպանության ընթացքին, հավատի և հայրենիքի համար, և որոնց
Christ our God, you crown your saints with triumph, and you do the will of all who fear you, looking after your creatures with love and kindness. Hear us from your holy and heavenly realm by the intercession of the Holy Mother of God, and by the prayers of all your saints, especially the holy martyrs who gave their lives during the Armenian Genocide for faith and for the homeland, whom we commemorate today. Hear us, Lord, and show us your mercy. Forgive, redeem, and pardon our sins. Make us worthy, thankfully, to glorify you with the Father and with the Holy Spirit, now and always, and unto the ages of ages. Amen. God bless you all.
As a United States Congressman and now a U.S. Senator, there are few in Congress who have known and been closer to our community than our next speaker. He was with us at the dedication of Armenian Heritage Park and spoke passionately about our cause, as I know he will again today. The Deputy Senator from Massachusetts, our friend, the Honorable Edward Markey.
Thank you, James, so much. Hered Pariyadak. Thank you for everything which you have done for today as well. Thank you for that kind introduction. Thank you for your incredible leadership of the American Heritage Foundation, the Armenian Heritage Foundation. Thank you for bringing all these incredibly talented young Armenian Americans up here to perform for us today. It was absolutely incredible. I joined you here in 2012 at the dedication of this special place. Governor Patrick, thank you again for all of your tremendous work to make this possible. It is our honor, Senator Warren and I, Mike Capuano, and the Massachusetts delegation to represent this fantastic Armenian American community from Massachusetts, but across our entire country. I was proud to represent Watertown, the font of all Armenian heritage in the United States of America. And now, as one of the two senators with Elizabeth Warren from Massachusetts, the entire diaspora, as it has moved into community after community across our great Commonwealth. And on Wednesday night in Washington, at a commemoration of the Armenian Holocaust, Peter Katusian was the master of ceremonies for every senator and house member of the United States of America. Peter did an absolutely fantastic job at that event. So here's what I've learned over all of the years that I have represented Armenian Americans in Massachusetts. I have never met an unsuccessful Armenian American in the United States of America. And our job is to make sure that there are no unsuccessful Armenians in Armenia, to work for that population as well. And no small part of that success comes from this community's deep appreciation for their lives, for the grace of time not afforded to many of their families and ancestors. As the Holocaust survivor and activist Simon Wiesenthal said, survival is a privilege that entails obligations. Some may have called it the forgotten genocide, but today we say that we will never forget, and we understand the great privilege and obligations borne by those who live. And one of our obligations is to acknowledge the genocide. When I was in the House of Representatives, I was an original co-sponsor of the Armenian Genocide Resolution every year. And in the Senate, I have not stopped. I was proud to cast an historic vote in the Senate Foreign Relations Committee last year, where I serve, in support of the Genocide Resolution. And while we are constantly being told that it is not the right time, it is always the right time to tell the truth. I will not stop fighting until the Senate passes this resolution and it is made clear that there is a conclusion that has been reached for a country that seeks to be a beacon of freedom and tolerance for the entire world. The United States must be the moral leader of the world if we expect the rest of the world to follow our leadership. But we cannot stop there. Last year, after I fought to have it shown in the White House, the Armenian orphan rug was finally displayed, but it was only shown for 5 days. We should not hide away from history. We should proudly display it for all to see. And although President Obama promised in his first campaign that he would promptly recognize the Armenian genocide, he has still not said the word we know he must say, genocide. And we all know what happened. We should not be afraid to say it. Pope Francis said the word genocide last week. The Germans and the Austrians who said the word genocide, those who were the perpetrators of the Jewish genocide, say it is important for all to recognize what happened in Armenia. Our president should call it a genocide, and he should call it a genocide now. It should not take another 100 years, not another 10 years, not even one more year for our government to recognize what our own ambassador described nearly one century ago. because as long as the world continues to be silent, the suffering continues. As long as nations continue to be quiet, we risk the same fate befalling new vulnerable populations. 100 years from now, will people say that we fulfilled our obligations to seek full recognition for those whose voices were silenced? 100 years from now, will our ancestors say that we acted with purpose, with resolve, and with honor? Because we know there's one certain truth about this issue. Turkey is wrong and the Armenians are white. And it is time for that to be recognized. I believe that by pushing for recognition of what happened, we don't just honor history, we will help avoid a repetition of what happened 100 years ago. We must continue to stand with our ally, Armenia, to address the challenges they face. We have a shared responsibility to ensure that the Armenian people are able to build their own independent and prosperous future. But for this to happen, it needs to be universal acknowledgement of the horror that was the Armenian Genocide. And that movement, that responsibility starts and ends with all of you, the privileged few who carry on their lives, not lived, the dreams not realized. 3 years ago, when we dedicated this park in the pouring rain, we knew that those were truly tears of joy coming out from heaven. A generation of Armenians living on that day. A memory that incredible time. And it is now your courage, your work, which is going to continue on this fight for justice. Shnor Hagelin. Thank you all.
If you can take our new lesson from Sheriff Kittu, then I can offer you a few of our options here. Might help. Thank you. Our final speaker is one of those refreshing elected officials who says what she will do, and then she does it once she's elected. During her campaign for the Senate, she committed to recognizing the Armenian Genocide and has followed through with her support in Washington. The senior senator from Massachusetts is the Honorable Elizabeth Warren.
Thank you. Thank you for the honor of inviting me to join you today. I am here to raise my voice, to join it with those who tell the truth. We are here today to remember the tragedy of 100 years ago because of the genocide of 1.5 million Armenians is an atrocity we must never forget. We come together to remember because if we do not recognize the horrors of the past, we risk seeing them repeated. We bear witness to genocide as part of our commitment that we will not permit such evil to walk the earth again. This week, through service and song, through lectures and liturgy, the Centennial Commemoration helps us come together to honor those whose lives were taken during the genocide, to celebrate the survivors, and to look to the future. That is why it is so important that we have the Armenian Heritage Park here in Boston. And I want to say, as so many others have, thank you, Governor, thank you, Congressman, thank you, Senator, and thank all of you who helped make this happen. This place stands as a permanent memorial to the tragedy of genocide suffered by the Armenian people. A tangible memory of a terrible event from the past. But this place also stands as a tribute to hope as it celebrates the significant contributions the Armenian community has made to our commonwealth, and it expresses the certainty that there will be many more celebrations to come. To everyone in the Armenian American community here in Massachusetts, and to everyone around the country who has worked to bring awareness and recognition to the Armenian genocide, I commend you for your efforts, and I thank you for your dedication. I have just one promise. We will not forget. Thank you.
Today's program, there is another group of people we would like to recognize and honor. After 100 years has passed, it's hard to believe, but we are blessed to have three survivors of the Armenian Genocide with us today. Stari Alemyan, Rosie Dersahakyan, and Mary Vartanyan, all over 100 years young. Conference. Then President Wilson sent a U.S. commission to Armenia and the Ottoman Empire to evaluate and better understand the plight of the survivors of the genocide perpetrated against the Armenian people. When General Harbord, who led the American military mission, was asked to comment, he replied, and I quote, "When the final decision is made that we as a nation will take no part in solving the problems of this region, there will be no member of our American military mission who will seek the duty of explaining our attitude and the abomination of desolation in this war-torn region. Someone who has not seen the horror of starvation can more satisfactorily present the virtue of our adherence to the non-entangling advice of George Washington, and inquire, as did Cain in the same neighborhood, am I my brother's keeper?" End quote. Today marks the 100th anniversary of the Armenian Genocide. Tomorrow begins the 101st anniversary of the Armenian Genocide. We as citizens of this great city and commonwealth, whose ancestors came to these shores to escape hardship and persecution, and by so doing afforded us all so many opportunities, have a moral duty to uphold the virtues and ideals upon which this great nation was founded. For the cause must go on, for the fight must never die. We must continue to loudly and consistently speak out against genocide and atrocities wherever they take place in the world, so that we can say never again, never again, never again. As we conclude today, kindly remain in your seats for a moment until we give our speakers a chance to exit. For those of you who will be with us tonight, the vigil begins promptly at 7:30 here in the park. The buses will be meeting you at Christopher Columbus Park across the way. Please walk safely, travel safely, and never forget. Thank you for being with us today.